Welcome this morning to the services of the North Hills Baptist Church. Good Sunday morning to you. Happy Mother's Day to all the ladies of our church and the friends of our church that are watching this morning. And happy Mother's Day. I take a liberty to the three special ladies in my life, Karen and Amy and Ashley. And one other liberty I'll say to Ashley this morning, happy birthday yesterday. To you, hope you had a good day, and I hope all the ladies have a special day this morning as we meet with God for a few minutes and then enjoy perhaps our families a little bit later today. The psalmist said, I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord. Now, we're not going per se into the house of the Lord this morning, but we are going into Bible study. And I hope that while we're there, we will glean some things that God has for us. We're in a series, Christianity A to Z, and we'll talk about that a little bit. But the psalmist also had these words to say, oh, how I love your law. It is my meditation all the day. How sweet are your words to my taste. Yes, sweeter than honey to my mouth. From your precepts, I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false way. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And I'm praying that that will happen and is happening to us as we glean from God's word today some things concerning prayer. One note, a sad note this morning to mention to you that Betty Harkey this morning is in the presence of the Lord. This past Wednesday evening, she went home to be with him, and I hope that you're remembering the family as they grieve, and private services are planned later this week for her. So just lift this up, this dear lady. We're certainly going to miss her. Almost five complete months, she's either been in ICU or the hospital or a nursing home, and it's just been a terrible ordeal for her. She's at rest this morning, no pain. The former things have passed away, and all things have become new to her. So let's have a word of prayer together. God bless you there in your home, and it's a joy to speak to you and to be with you today through the means of TV. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the blessings of worship, and we thank you for the care that you're giving to us, and I pray that you'll continue to watch over our church family and the friends of our church family that tune in each week. I pray that you'll keep us safe, and God, you'll watch over, keep a hedge of protection about our lives. I thank you for this morning and for our time to sing and to worship and to study your word. May you be honored. May you be pleased with what we do. And when we finish, I trust that everything said and done will have been in accordance with your will. Please keep us safe and free from this terrible pandemic time that we're in. And I just give you the praise for that. And we'll be back together soon. And I just trust until it comes that you'll just bless our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna,
'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
Church, sing that again with us.
In your presence, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna. The God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna.
Sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not care. Temptations, is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge. To the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
I need thee every hour, most gracious. gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford.
I need thee every hour, stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh.
I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
I need thee every hour. In joy or pain, come quickly and abide, or life is vain.
I need thee every hour. Teach me thy will. Thy promise is so rich in me fulfilled.
I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me thine indeed, thou blessed Son. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Father, we need you every hour of every day, every minute, dare we say, of every day. God, we are so thankful for your blessings in our lives. We are thankful for the truths of your word. We are thankful for the promise of salvation that you give, that you've given us through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus. As we continue our worship this morning, Father, we ask that you would change lives, that we would have a desire to serve you as we have never done before, that we would strip away all the burdens, that we would tear away all of the idols in our lives, that we would focus solely on you, and that we would make you the centerpiece of our lives. Father, bless your word. Bless your truths. Bless our pastor as he brings the bread of life today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I'd like to say a very special thank you to Becky and the guys this morning for coming each Sunday and making our service very special. And to Chris and Priscilla and Nick upstairs running the show, thank you. God bless you. I'm sure you have other things maybe you could have been doing this morning, but each Sunday, thank you so much to all of you for making these services special. This morning we continue our study on Christianity A to Z, and we started 2 weeks ago with the thought of the famous football coach that called his men together at the very outset of the season and held a football up and said, guys, This is a football. And we're getting back to the basics. Now, he was talking to professional players. He was talking about to men that were being paid many hundreds of thousands of dollars to play the game. And he was talking to people that knew football. I know I'm speaking to congregation of people this morning that have been in the family of God for a number of years. I get that. But I think sometimes just getting back to the very basics of Christianity reminds us of where we are, how we started, and where we need to be, and how we can become better people along the way. So that's what my goal has been, and that's what my goal is. 2 weeks ago, we started talking about the beginning of Christianity, and that means that it began in my life, and it did for you as well, by trusting Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Because you were born into a home where people are saved doesn't make you a Christian. I heard someone say one time, any more so than taking some brand new born kittens and placing them in a bread basket will make a single one of them a biscuit. So it's true, and I don't mean to make light of that, but you have to come into the family of God, not by joining a church, not by listening to me on a Sunday morning, but by a relationship with Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And then last Sunday we talked about the importance of Bible study. Once we're in the family, once we know Christ, we want to know more about Him and what He wants for our lives. And so Bible study comes into play. And that passage in the 19th division of Psalm talked about how David wrote about the glory of God. The heavens, he said, declares the greatness of God. And the scriptures declare the glory of God and the greatness of God as well. And along the way in that passage, David cried out, "Oh, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight." And so as he saw himself as a sinner, he cries out for the grace of God. So the glory of God and the greatness of God and the grace of God is so important, and it's seen in the scripture. I hope you'll get into the Word of God, and if you're not already, and study it. So this morning, what is the next component to the basics of Christianity? Knowing Christ and being in Him, knowing about Him through the study of God's Word, and then communicating with Him through prayer. And that's our thought today. Colossians chapter 4 will be our reading this morning, and we're going to talk about prayer. And that's a good thing, a wonderful thing. Prayer is something that that we all are involved in at some point in time. But my goal this morning is to get back to the basics and to talk with you about and reaffirming with you, if that needs to be done, the importance of spending time with God. I think in the New Testament church this day, in this age, and maybe in all the ages, I don't know, but at least in this one, the greatest tragedy is not unanswered prayer. I think the greatest tragedy in the New Testament church today is unoffered prayer. And we just go about our business and we forget to pray. We talk about prayer. It's an important thing. We sing about prayer. They did this morning. What a friend we have in Jesus. Get started in that. The fellowship that we have with Him through prayer. We even teach about prayer, the importance of prayer. But is that enough? If we know the things about God and we don't do them, is that enough? And I don't think so. So let's read this morning together, Colossians chapter 4. I'd like to begin with verse 2 and read through verse 5. Paul writes and says, "Devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving, praying at the same time for us as well, that God will open up to us a door for the word, so that we may speak forth the mystery of Christ, for which I have also been imprisoned, that I may make it clear in the way I ought to speak, Conduct yourselves with wisdom toward outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. Amen. May God bless the reading of His Word this morning. And I appreciate these in our sanctuary that stand in honor of the reading of God's Word. And maybe you did at home as well. I hope so, quite frankly. Pray without ceasing was the admonition of the Apostle Paul. What did he mean by that? I'm going to pray without ceasing. Does that mean that I am to bend my knee and bow my head and every waking moment be in prayer to God? And the answer to that is no. The attitude that we should have about prayer is that we're going to be a part of God's communicating with Him constantly. He meant an attitude of prayer in my life. He's talking about me staying near the cross of Christ. He's talking about me drawing near to the Father and staying as close as I can. And you do that by communicating and thinking about it. I pray in my vehicle all the time. It doesn't mean that my head is bowed and my eyes are closed, obviously. But I love to by myself meditate and think about and lift up sometimes people they come to my mind and that's you, and I lift you up to God and things of my life and our home and things. And I think that's exactly what Paul meant when he said pray without ceasing. And in this passage this morning of Colossians, he offers, I think, four things that we can look at that I have been a blessing for me to study it, and I hope it'll be a blessing to present it to you this morning. And I think the first thing the opening thought is this, that we ought to pray persistently. That we ought to be praying persistently. And that opening verse, in verse 2, he says to devote yourselves to prayer. To be devoted to prayer. Continue steadfastly in prayer is one translation. Another one says, steadfastly commit yourself to prayer. We get the word devote, being steadfastly involved in the praying. All of that, I think, combines to say pray persistently. We are drawn to our knees occasionally because something bad, something heavy upon our hearts, something bad in our lives, a tragedy comes, a sorrow happens, great decisions need to be made. We find ourselves spending our time in the presence of God and asking for direction and seeking His will and counsel and things. But this ought to be done, I think, daily. This should be a matter that we bring before God, our lives, our hearts, our conditions, daily. Spending time with our great God. Listen, in Luke chapter 9, there's that famous scripture that says these words, "Ask and it shall be given to you." Remember that? "Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you." Now here's what's interesting about that verse. And I am by no means a Greek scholar. But here's what I know about that verse. The tense in the original language is a present tense with what is called an active voice. And here's what it means. Ask and keep on asking. Knock and keep on knocking. Seek and keep on seeking. So you ask me how often, how much should I pray about something? How often and how much should I ask God to grant this need or meet this request? And the answer comes back is in one of three ways. God will answer with a no. If it's no, then move on to something else. If it's a yes, then you've got your answer. But sometimes it's just wait. So you've got a yes, no, or a wait. But when God has moved in that, then it's time to move on. You do not keep asking, seeking, and knocking. Be persistent, however, in your prayer and your praying. Come before the Lord continually and let your request be made known. The most amazing thing that I'm going to tell you this morning, and it won't be just shocking news, The most amazing thing to me about this service and what I'm saying to you this morning on the subject of prayer is this, that the King of Glory has invited us into His throne room. We can talk with Him. We can meet with Him. We can lift our burdens up to Him. We can visit with Him. And He asks us to bring our cares, and He bring our concerns and our hearts hurt, to share with Him what's in our mind, what troubles my heart, what troubles your heart, what's in your life. We have been invited into the very presence of the King of Glory. And we can do that on any and every occasion. Obedience to the Word of God and persistence in our prayer life is something that Paul says we ought to be involved in. We ought to be the very thing we're noted for is prayer. I hope that you feel that way about me as your pastor, that you are prayed for daily. I hope I can feel the same from you, and I do, quite frankly. It is something about praising Him and exalting Him and talking to Him and visiting with Him that brings joy to the Christian's life. So pray persistently. And then the passage also suggests that we should pray passionately. Passionately. In verse 2, we have the word in the New American Standard, alert. In the King James, it's the word watch. But it has the idea, the English word, of our English word, of being vigilant. That we pray with great enthusiasm, with excitement. Again, why? Because we're in the throne room of our Heavenly Father. And I'll tell you, I think to write a prayer down and to read it or recite it over and over is an insult to God. We need to pray, and I think we need to pray passionately and talk to Him just like we would to our earthly Father. We want something, and when I wanted something from my dad and I really wanted it, I could beg with the best of them. I could grovel and cry and tear up and all these things. I'm not talking about a fakey thing with God. I'm talking about coming before Him and laying our heart before Him and telling Him what's going on in our lives. A good look at Jesus Christ gives us, first of all, the example of what prayer and praying should be. He prayed at His temptation. He prayed with His disciples. He prayed at His transfiguration. And who of us can forget what we call it, the high priestly prayer that He prayed in John, recorded in John chapter 17, on the night that He was betrayed and the trials that He went through as He prayed for those around Him and for those who were yet to come and those who were yet to come with the believers in the world. That would be you and I. He is our example of prayer. He teaches us how to pray. He tells us how important it is. Listen, if it was important for Him to pray, it's important for me to pray. And it's important for you to pray. Not only did He teach us, did he give us an example, but He teaches us how to pray. His disciples said to Him one day, "Lord, teach us to pray." That's a fair question. And so among the things He said on the sermon given on what's called the Sermon on the Mount, in the early chapters of Matthew, was the example of how to pray. And we have what's recorded there. It's known as the model prayer. Some things about, He also has some things to say about some do's and don'ts in those passages about praying as well. He says, don't be like the Pharisees. They love their long prayers, and they love to stand on the street corners where people can see them, and they love to pray where they can be overheard by people saying, well, look how humble he is, and how pious he is, and how godly he is. He says, don't be like the Pharisees. He says, when you pray, enter your closet and pray like this. And we have the model prayer that's been recorded that we read from, and we know what he wants. It starts off and says, Our Father. He was telling his disciples, when you pray, pray to our Father, to your Heavenly Father, and say, and call him by name, and say, hallowed be your name. Glory to you. Holiness comes to you, he was saying. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day, and give us our daily bread. Provide for me today, and I trust that you will for tomorrow. And don't lead me into temptation, and forgive me of my sins, and help me to be a better person, and help me to love others and to forgive others, because thine is the kingdom, and thine is the power, and thine is the glory forever. And then he concluded by saying, amen, so be it. He taught us to pray, and I think he taught us to pray enthusiastically, if you will, with vigilance, with great passion, with excitement that we're in the presence of Almighty God. And I'm going to pause for just a second and tell you about me, a little bit about me and prayer, and it might include you as well. Because I'm going to tell you that I don't always want to pray. I don't always feel to be in the mood to pray. I said that about Bible study last week. It's that old battle that we have between the spirit and the flesh. And my flesh can give me 1,000 reasons why I ought not to read God's word. And my flesh can give me 1,000 reasons why I can do something else rather than pray. But I also know this, that when I feel the least like praying is when I need to pray the most. I know that to be true. And I'm not just trying to say something kind of smart or cute. I just know that to be true. When I don't want to pray is the time, Brother Steve, I just need to pray. I really do. Brother Ronnie, it's true, is it not, for all of us? In those moments when I'm not happy about how things turned out, I need to go to my knees and speak to my Heavenly Father about it. I need to seek His face and find out what's going on in His life. Do you find that true, Bart? I just find that so true for me. It's that time when I find that, like the song says, that I must trust and obey, for there is no other way to be happy in Jesus than by trusting and obeying. So pray persistently, pray passionately, pray, he says in verse 2, gratefully. He says with thanksgiving, with an attitude of thanksgiving. Is this not the theme of the Bible, of the New Testament especially? Is this not the theme of the writers of the New Testament, where they occasionally just launch into this idea of thanksgiving and being grateful for what God has done? Paul does this. Peter does this. James does this. They tell us that we ought to have a heart that is grateful to God for what He's doing and who He is and what He's doing for us. We give thanks for this is the will of God, says the scripture concerning you. A grateful prayer, a grateful person in prayer, I think, indicates in that individual's life at that particular moment a dependence upon God. And that is so important. We need that, do we not? And whether you know it or not, you can have good health and maybe all the money that you need in the bank, and you'll probably pray a lot less with those two things. When you come before God and you speak to Him, it is, first of all, I think, an act of humility. You come into His presence. We don't come with a haughty spirit and a haughty attitude. It's an admission that when we bow our knees, we get before Him, it is an admission of humility, that we need Him, that we want Him in our lives, that we are desperate for Him. Gratefulness generates humility in our lives, and I think that's a good thing. We give, and we live in a world that does not promote humility for the most part. You and I live in a world where we are told, because we are Americans, that we can make it, that we got all we need to lift ourselves up and to do this or to do that. But the truth of the matter is, for the child of God, we need Him. We need the Spirit of God in our lives, directing us and leading us. And it brings about our dependence upon Him and the humility that ought to be there when we address Him. When you come into His presence, gratefully, thankfully, you are saying, "It is not by my flesh, but by your Spirit." We say, "It's not by my power, but it's by your power." And it is not going to be done by my might, but by yours. And as we know so well from the wonderful song this morning, we've got a friend in Jesus, and He sticketh closer than a brother. So we want to pray, Paul says, I think, persistently and passionately and gratefully. And then the final thing this morning, I think he says in verse 3 here that we should also be praying selflessly. Selflessly. Because he writes this letter to this church at Colossae, and he says to them, "Will you pray for us?" Now, Paul sends this letter to them because he's writing it from a Roman prison. It's one of the prison epistles, if you will. So why does Paul, who's writing God's word, who is a man of God, why would he want them to pray for him? Let's set aside the fact that he's in prison. I think he's asking for their prayerful support because he needs to know what to do next. He wants God's direction on what to write next. He wants God's direction on where to go next if he's able to get out of prison. What's next for me? Will you lift me up to the Lord? Will you pray for us? He says, and it's a plural there. Pray. Listen, we're talking about praying for others. And the word is interceding for others, or intercession. Something that we all ought to be doing is praying for someone else. Don't you have someone that you lift up every day to the Lord, or often when you pray? Aren't you lifting your family up to the Lord? Aren't you lifting up those of your church family that have health issues and needs? Remember this past year we went through our Who's Your One? Aren't you still lifting up that one that's still unsaved? I am. I do that every week. We ought to pray and learn to be interceding or intercessing for those that need our prayers. Whether they know it or not, we ought to be interceding for them. So we want to examine our hearts and lives and see why, maybe, church, why we're not praying like we ought to be praying. I'm not giving this as a downer this morning. I don't want you to feel guilt. I just, unless you need to, but I would like you to feel that this is something very important to God, therefore it has to be with me. And I make this plea to you this morning. Include me in your prayers. If it's not done but ever so often, would you do that when you talk to the Lord? Would you mention my name? Would you mention my family? Would you lift us up to the Lord? Prayer is not the last resort. It's the first thing that we ought to be doing. And I say to you, based on what I've already said, you're never more like Jesus than when you're praying, when you're interceding for others. Scripture says that there was a day that Jesus lifted up his eyes and he saw the multitudes, and he was moved, it says, with compassion for them. He saw the multitudes. And I'm maybe a little facetious here about me, but not maybe much. Typically, when I see the multitudes, I'm thinking, how long am I going to have to sit on this freeway? Typically, when I see the multitudes, I'm thinking, how long will I have to sit in this line? He saw the multitudes and was moved with compassion. I think we need to see people like Jesus did. He saw people that needed his love. He saw people that he wanted to pray for. He was moved because he saw people that he was going to die for. And I think if we could see people like that, people that need love, people that need Christ, people that need a new way, a better hope, I think we, as members of the North Hills Baptist Church, we who are Christians in this world we're living in, this pandemic world we're living in, we could become the mighty prayer warriors that we ought to be. Thank you so much for being a part of our service this morning. I hope that the music and the message has been a blessing to you. I hope that you will take some things that I've said these last 3 weeks especially. If you're not saved this morning, the most important thing is that you come to know Jesus, get into the family of God, and then get into his word and enjoy time with him in prayer. You will never regret any of that. The only regret that you're going to have is that I didn't do more of it when I had a chance, that I didn't come into the family when I should have. Have a good day. God bless all you dear ladies out there and moms. Happy Mother's Day to you. We'll be back in services here some soon day. We think it'll be maybe in June, but we don't know that right now. We're meeting, and we'll be meeting and discussing what's best for North Hills and for us. But we pray that God will give us wisdom to know when we're supposed to do all these things, okay? Have a good day. Have a blessed week, and I will see you along the way. Our Father, we thank you for our time together this morning. Thank you for every person that has listened and been a part of our service today. And I just pray that something was said that will make a difference for eternity, for lives, for this church, and for your cause. Thank you for the mothers that have listened this morning and will this week, and you bless their lives and heart. We thank you for godly mothers. Forgive our sins now. Give us a good week, one in which we find many opportunities to serve you. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.